Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. About 2 weeks ago, I took my leave of you all with a simple request. I'm going to miss next week, I said, so let's make sure no tech news happens. Minimal news of the tech variety. And did you guys come through? I have no idea. I was checked out pretty much all week. But thankfully, I have checked back in, and just in the nick of time, because this week's news has been unprecedented. Intel is back from the brink of disaster thanks to life-saving infusions from SoftBank and good old Uncle Sam. NVIDIA is doing just what we asked them to do, lowering gaming GPU prices while producing fewer AI chips. And Gamers Nexus finally dropped their 3.5-hour-long magnum opus on banned GPU smuggling in China, only to have their video banned by a Bloomberg DMCA so nobody can watch it ever again. Or can they? Summer may be drawing to a close, but it's still really f***ing hot outside. Time for tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair Frame 4000D computer case, available in a variety of configurations thanks to the Frame modular case system. Customize your cooling with the InfiniRail fan mounting system, use removable panels to cover cables or mount fans to guide the Frame 4000D's high airflow pathways, or go for a clutter-free build thanks to reverse connector motherboard compatibility. There's also room for dual 360mm radiators and included GPU anti-sag support and easy IQ Link integration for RGB control and system monitoring. For more on the Corsair Frame 4000D, click the sponsor link in the video description. Intel was able to bankroll its continued existence this week thanks to a double dose of what the ailing chip manufacturer needs most: money, cash, liquid currency via direct deposit. And the first installment came Tuesday when it was announced that conglomerate SoftBank will be taking a $2 billion stake in Intel, which sounds like a lot, but is actually just a 2% slice of Team Blue. Current Intel CEO Lip-Bu Tan, whose rosy outlook on the company's prospects often reads like a preemptive eulogy, was on the SoftBank board up until 2022, so it's nice to know that his old buddies from his former gig are willing to toss a few bucks his way to get Intel through these hard times. Of course, the $2 billion won't keep Intel afloat forever, and the money might have had ulterior motives, staying in the good graces of the current US president possibly being one of them. And here, unfortunately, tech crosses paths with politics once again, since Intel is the only leading-edge chip fabricator that's US-based, and staying ahead in this area is actually pretty important for, you know, national security and stuff. The government doesn't want Intel to fail, so much so that the Trump administration has its own idea for helping out Team Blue by actually buying a 10% stake in them, which was apparently agreed to on Friday. There's obviously a whole quagmire of opinion on whether or not the US government should do this, but the government doesn't seem to care too much about your opinion these days, and neither do the board members of conglomerates who can toss a $2 billion bone to Intel just to curry some favor with the US president. Forget about all those ethical qualms, because the line has gone up. Based on both of these newses, Intel stock rallied to levels not seen since, since the height of the dot-com bubble in the early 2000s. Probably just a coincidence, though. Speaking of bursted bubbles, Gamers Nexus was riding high on the many accolades and positive feedbacks that rolled in after they published their GPU smuggling documentary, the extended edition, with a 3.5-hour running time, which I will not attempt to summarize here. I did watch the whole thing, though, and in particular, I enjoyed hearing from people in Hong Kong and China who are part of the smuggling supply chain, even if they aren't really breaking any US laws by going about their business in China. And it was amusing to see the ready availability of supposedly banned for export GPUs like the RTX 5090 in tech shopping districts both in Hong Kong and the mainland. There's a fascinating segment on repair and repurposing of GPUs, such as doubling an RTX 4090's VRAM to 48GB, but most poignant for me were the timelines of changes to tariffs and export restrictions for GPUs going back to when ChatGPT was first introduced, which was also when the government began to get seriously involved. Because while public AI use might center around chatbots, video and image generation, and AI automation that might threaten jobs, at the state level, the concern is weapons development and defense and dystopian AI capabilities like mass surveillance and facial recognition, which is already very much a thing. NVIDIA has been doing their best to navigate all this with grace and maximum profits, of course, but it's tough to speak out both sides of your mouth, allegedly, for so long without people noticing. NVIDIA is US-based, yes, and Jensen touts keeping the US, aka NVIDIA, at the forefront of AI tech. But in courting government officials and attending million-dollar White House dinners, his actual goal is to get them to loosen export restrictions so NVIDIA can once again sell their AI GPUs, which are manufactured in Taiwan and often assembled in China, to China, with the most recent version being the H20. More on that in a second. The point here is that Steve's epic documentary was, quite predictably, DMCA'd within a few days. So Steve is now fighting a strike, and the DMCA was issued by Bloomberg, supposedly for the 22-minute to 23 minutes and 15 seconds time frame of the video, which includes a fair amount of President Trump, I'm gonna say, talking about NVIDIA and AI technology, as well as screenshots of written articles and voiceover, which are all clearly within the realm of fair use, in my opinion. But gosh, if only they had foreseen this abuse of the DMCA system and hundreds of fans had downloaded the video so it could be re-uploaded forever. I asked Steve for a spicy comment on the takedown, and he said, "Bloomberg is causing direct and ongoing financial harm to Gamers Nexus with its illegitimate copyright strike claiming a speech by the President of the United States. Also, it can shove its copyright strike up its ass right next to the NVIDIA sponsorship money. You can put that on record." And well said, Steve. Getting back to NVIDIA though, since Jensen schmoozed a handful of influential government officials, those officials have gone and run their mouths about NVIDIA tech, particularly with regards to the US or NVIDIA being able to track AI chips after they're sold, which NVIDIA denies, but reps from the US and China have said is totally a thing, as well as the supposed reliance the rest of the world is developing on NVIDIA technology for AI advances. And of course, as you now know, NVIDIA and the US, basically the same thing. NVIDIA tech is USA tech. But since China doesn't want to be reliant on US tech, especially for AI, and since China seems to still think chips like the H20 can be tracked or even backdoored, and since people like US Secretary of Commerce Howard Lutnick are making comments about China becoming addicted to the American technology stack, the demand for the H20 in China seems to have disappeared. And per reports, NVIDIA is halting their production of the H20, although I would imagine they'll be producing some other extremely high profit margin AI chip in its stead. Or maybe, just like in the Gamers Nexus video, many of those halfway manufactured GPUs will just stay in China to be repurposed. But if I may attempt to steer this week's show back to the direction of consumer PC hardware, NVIDIA's other move this week seems to have been on the GeForce side, where, as I covered in GPU Price Watch, prices have continued to drop, thankfully, with even higher-end cards like the RTX 5070 Ti, 5080, and even 5090 now available, pretty much, for MSRP in the US. And elsewhere, the news is even better, as new official pricing has been rolled out in Europe, though this could be due to supply, or the weakening US dollar versus the euro, or perhaps both. The 5070, 5080, and 5090 have all been priced down by about 9-10%, and hopefully everyone can agree that cheaper consumer GPUs for good old-fashioned video games is a good thing. Now, do some sales, NVIDIA. Speaking of GPUs, oh, and by the way, we're doing tech briefs now. Here's an RTX 5090 that will likely never sell for the $2,000 MSRP, the ASUS ROG Matrix RTX 5090 30th Anniversary Limited Edition, which goes hard not just with the phallic design, patented vapor chamber cooler, and liquid metal TIM, but also with a 2730MHz overclock via 800-watt mode. 800 watts, you say, but I thought the notoriously unreliable 12V2x6 connector was only rated for 600 watts. You're right! The ROG Matrix 30th edition comes with two of these connectors, one being the modular edge connector that's made to swap out for BTF builds, and either that one or the traditional one can pump 800 watts, according to ASUS, though I would have a hard time not being nervous running that 24/7. Perhaps that's why they're only making 1,000 of these. Speaking of the notoriously unreliable 12V2x6 connector, if we needed further proof that the spec was inherently flawed, it arrived this week. For the first time, an AMD card, the Radeon RX 9070 XT, melted a 12V2x6 connector, which was bound to happen eventually. The card in question was an ASRock Tai Chi, which should only draw between 300 and 350 watts, but still managed to achieve catastrophic failure, though it was thankfully the card's PEG adapter cable that melted and not the card itself. Also, thankfully, there are not many RX 9070 XTs with this connector, just the ASRock model and a couple from Sapphire. Many asked why ASRock and Sapphire decided to use this connector instead of standard 8 pins when the cards were launched, and this is why people asked that question. Finally, because we are ultimately all just soldiers in the PC versus console wars, I have news to report. Sony is raising the PS5 price by $50. They say it's because of tariffs, but we all know the real reason is to make PC gamers feel just a bit better about spending as much as a PS5 costs on just our GPUs. Still, a console will likely be the only option for playing GTA 6 before 2030 if PC is your primary gaming platform, and now the price of the console has gone up too. And here I was thinking this would be a more lighthearted story to end the show. I guess you could always just buy an Xbox Series X instead. I'm just kidding. I guess we did end on a lighthearted note. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise like t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone. It's good to be back, and we'll see you next week.